All right, so the point of confusion here was Muslims cherish noble and universal values such as, and then it says allowing freedom of religion.
Sure.
So this is, at any sort of Westerner who reads that would think that Islam has freedom of religion as a universal value. So then, noble and universal values such as freedom of religion. Well, I'm thinking of things like death penalty for apostasy. So you leave Islam, you convert to something else, and you get put to death. So I'm saying when someone who's walking by here and takes your trap, takes a look at that.
Takes my trap?
Take trap. Come on, Dave. We call these tracks.
Tracks?
These are called tracks.
What's the track?
T-R-A-C-T, tracks.
Oh, tracks. That's what they're
called.
That's
cool. We normally think of, I mean, as far as Christians handing them out, we normally think of pamphlets as something thicker, and then tracks as like a one full.
We just think of sharing a value, but okay. So guys, so let me explain something to you.
Okay.
When you talk about, first thing, the idea of religious freedom, okay? In the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, peace and blessings be upon him, were there Christians and Jews that lived in Medina, lived under the Khilafah, and were able to pray, have churches and things, or no?
We were sitting in the mosque when the Messenger of Allah came to us and said, "Let us go to the Jews." We went out with him until we came to them. The Messenger of Allah stood up and called out to them saying, "O ye assembly of Jews, accept Islam and you will be safe." They said, "Abul Qasim, you have communicated God's message to us." The Messenger of Allah said, "Accept Islam and you would be safe." They said, "Abul Qasim, you have communicated Allah's message." The Messenger of Allah said the same words the third time, and on getting the same reply, he added, "You should know that the earth belongs to Allah and his apostle, and I wish that I should expel you from this land. Those of you who have any property with them should sell it, otherwise they should know that the earth belongs to Allah and his apostle, and they may have to go away leaving everything behind." It has been narrated on the authority of Ibn Umar that the Jews of Banu Nadir and Banu Qurayza fought against the Messenger of Allah, who expelled Banu Nadir and allowed Qurayza to stay on, and granted favor to them until they too fought against him. Then he killed their men and distributed their women, children and properties among the Muslims. Except that some of them had joined the Messenger of Allah, who granted them security. They embraced Islam. The Messenger of Allah turned out all the Jews of Medina, Banu Qaynuqa, the tribe of Abdullah B. Salim, and the Jews of Banu Harida and every other Jew who was in Medina.
It was being narrated by Umar B. al-Khatib that he heard the Messenger of Allah say, "I will expel the Jews and the Christians from the Arabian Peninsula, and I will not leave any but Muslims." Sahih Muslim, 1767, Book 32, Hadith 75. Now, the argument of Ibn Farouk is that we don't understand these hadiths because we are not scholars. And in fact, if we see in Islamic history, coexistence of Muslims with Christians in the Arabian Peninsula was common. Of course, now there aren't any, exactly as Muhammad said, but okay, that's a side note. In the past, there were Jews in the Arabian Peninsula. I mean, just look the world around you. Do you see anywhere Muslims prosecuting religious minorities? Nowhere. In Egypt, for example, that it used to be Christian, you can still today find Christians. I think there is one that has a grocery store. Also in Afghanistan, that used to be Christian, now you can find many Christians riding unicorns. In India, for example, we all know how Muslims, when conquering India, they respected the Hindu religion. We will never know the number of temples desecrated through India's history, written and eaten. 60,000 temples were demolished under Muslim rule. The professor of history explains how he came up with a figure of 80. So, Ibn Farouk, how about India? Did Muslims respect it? Hinduism? They just killed 80 million and 60,000 temples. 60,000 temples they destroyed. So let me understand your argument. Although Muslim scriptures seem to preach intolerance to other religions, that's not the case because in Islamic history, as everybody knows, Muslims coexisted peacefully with other religions. What? What did you say? What did you say? Okay, now let's go to the persecution of Christians today. At near genocide levels today, that is today, guys. The persecution of Christians in parts of the world is at near genocide levels, according to the report ordered by Foreign Secretary Jeremy Hunt. The review led by the Bishop of Truro, the Right Reverend Philip, blah, 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 estimated that one in three people suffer from religious persecutions. Christians were the most persecuted religious group, it found. Okay. One is about genocide against Christians. The interim report said the main impact of genocidal acts against Christians is exodus, and that Christianity faced being wiped out from parts of the Middle East. My friend, I am Greek. I happen to be Greek. Okay, let's see. I'm a random person that happens to be Greek. Let's see what Islam did to Greeks. Couple of genocides in Mikra Asia. Couple of genocides. 400 years you was under Islamic control. So you enslave the Greek population for 400 years. That's just a random person. and you have to... Ah, look. Look, it goes on. You took in the children of Greeks. You made them janissaries, genitsarus. And you made the children of Greeks fight their own parents. How about that? Persecution? No persecution. No persecution. Really, eh? So, contrary to Islamic scriptures, reality contradicts that, eh? So, the first argument of Ibn Farouk, I think it fails. Someone might argue that it's Islam actually prosecuted some people. It's not completely peaceful.
Yeah, they ultimately became dhimmis, but I'm more thinking of, you know, we understand the dhimmi status and the jizya and so on. I'm more thinking of polytheists because anyone here who hears universal value, freedom of religion, would think that there is no death penalty for leaving Islam or something like that. So that's what I'm wondering.
Let me clarify for you. I got you, Dave. So first thing to understand when you talk about universal freedom of religion, we need to understand what that encompasses, right? So, for example, when you had the Spanish Inquisition, right? You know about the Spanish Inquisition?
Yeah.
Okay. So when the Spaniards came, they didn't allow people to stay Muslim, right? It was either you convert or die, right?
Yeah.
Come on, David. I'm trying to deny it. You're on tape, bro.
Some cases, no. We
Spanish Inquisition.
We condemn violence, but the point is, it's not part of the religion. That's what people do.
I agree with
which
you.
Which is exactly what I'm sure you'd say about certain people.
I would. But the Spanish Inquisition is an example of not allowing the people to practice their religion.
True.
Either happens. You become Christian or die.
So I wouldn't call that freedom of religion.
Agreed. True. Right? In Islam, we don't have that. Even if you are a dhimmi or whatever, you have the right to keep to your religion. Nobody's going to force you to become Muslim.
Firstly, he doesn't know the history. The fact of the matter is the crimes that he is referring to were carried out by secular courts, not the Inquisitional court.
The Inquisitional court. It was the church.
Who's interrupting? Do you see how he can never keep to his own principles? The Inquisitional court was an ecclesiastical court. Only those that were confessing Catholics would appear in front of it. The people that he is talking about that were the Moroscos. The Moroscos were people who were confessing Christians, but they weren't practicing Islamic practices.
That is a lie.
That's what that those were the people
he's a liar, a lie. He doesn't know his
shit. Furthermore,
can I ask him a question?
No, I'm going to finish my point.
Then I'll finish your lie. Go on, finish
thank
your
thank you. Furthermore, furthermore, I defend the idea of an ecclesiastical court called the Inquisition. I've called for an Inquisition. I believe in the Inquisition. I want to see an Inquisition today. But I don't believe in burning people alive. I don't believe in torturing them. And no, I don't believe in killing them. But I do believe in an ecclesiastical court upholding orthodoxy and casting out heretics from the church.
But what do you do with them when you catch them?
By contrast.
Right, off topic. No, wait, wait, wait.
By contrast.
Yeah, finish.
We just heard Shamsi saying. We just heard Shamsi saying that he believes in torturing criminals because Muhammad tortured criminals.
Get it now, Ibn Farooq, the difference. Did you catch the difference? Christianity doesn't believe in torture. The Inquisition went against Christianity. You believe in torture. Islam believes in torture. Sharia uses torture. Sharia makes people deterrent flags. It uses torture for people to fear and don't do stuff against Islam. Your prophet Muhammad tortured people. That's the difference.
Agreed, right? In Islam, we don't have that. Even if you are a dhimmi or whatever, you have the right to keep to your religion. Nobody's going to force you to become Muslim. Is that right?
Fight those who do not believe in Allah or in the last day and who do not consider unlawful what Allah and His Messenger have made unlawful and who do not adapt the religion of truth from those who were given the scriptures. Fight until they given the jizya, willingly, while they are humbled. First of all, let's ignore the stupidity required for someone to believe that God actually demands taxes, and it's not humans writing these verses. But then let's see what was the jizya.
Allahu Akbar. Jihad al-talab innaka anta tujahid tatlab al-kuffar hatta taftah bilad al-kuffar wa tadkhulhum bil-islam. وإذا أبوا الإسلام يؤمرون بالجزية وإن أبوا أن يعطوا الجزية قتلوا.
So if you only think that this is part of history, you're dead wrong. So here you have the Taliban's asking the non-Muslims to wear a badge to identify them as a non-Muslims. And if they are identified as non-Muslims, then anyone on the street can push them, spit on them, mistreat them. They're easy to spot. So harassing people and mistreating them on the street based on their disbelief is part of Islamic way. So as you can see here in this report, you can see that Muhammad said that whoever you meet on the streets, the Jews or Christians, then you push them to the narrowest portion. You force them basically, you mistreat them. And if you go further down in this report, you see that Muslims are ordered to humiliate them. So here you see you have different rules for different people based on different categories. That is jizya for you guys. Let's continue. What is the purpose of jizya according to Islamic scripture? Well, I'm going to show you here what I found. So according to Quran 9:29, it says here, you fight them until they pay the jizya with willing submission and feel themselves subdued. So submission is very important. The Messenger of Allah said, remember, we are looking for the purpose of jizya. The Messenger of Allah said, I was sent with the sword before the hour, basically before the judgment day, so that Allah will be worshipped alone without partners. My provision was placed under the shadow of the spear. And those who defy it, basically those who don't want to be Muslims, or are Muslims and are basically Coca-Cola light Muslims.
For example, open Bukhari, you will find a hadith that if you find a Jew or a Christian walking down the street, push them to the side. It is well known from what Umar ibn al-Khattab and the Khulafa al-Rashidin used to implement, that the Jew and Christian was not allowed to ride on a horse when the Muslim is riding on the horse. They will have to walk. Allah, He said in the Quran about the jizya, that you that fight the people of the book. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, it's in the Quran, fight the people of the book and those who do not believe that what Allah has made lawful as lawful and what Allah has made unlawful as lawful until they pay the jizya and feel themselves subdued. The purpose of the jizya is to make the Jew and the Christian know that they are inferior and subjugated to Islam. Okay? In the Muslim state, although the Jew and Christian is free to practice their religion, this is allowed, but they cannot display their cross. And even in the time of Umar, they were not allowed to reconstruct or construct new churches. All of this is to create an atmosphere where it is encouraging the people to come to Iman and Islam.
So that is the jizya. There is no question about it. Okay. Whoever says the opposite is either ignoramus, either he's lying. The jizya is simply this flag. The stupidity required for someone to believe that God actually demands jizya, and it's not people that wrote these laws and words, is okay. What can I say?
Do I need to say anything more? Evil.
That was Takia Watch. Please visit his channel. It's very, very good.
Cost me?
No.
All right. I'm here to help you, Dave. I got you.
Well, it kind of seems like you're deflecting.
I'm really not.
Because it's
I'm
a very simple thing. Yeah. Are Muslims allowed to leave Islam in a Muslim state?
I'll answer that. But first, I want you to understand.
That's my really only objection to that part.
Because your question that came up from you was about Surah Tawbah. So I'm just trying to explain to you so you don't go the rest of your life with this misconception, making videos without being ignorant of what Am and Khas is, right? There are certain verses that are for certain situations. You need to learn that before you make videos. And certain that are general. The particular is called khas. Some are about jihad, about the time of fighting. Some are about the Quraysh who were oppressing Muslims at that time. But
yeah, but your God forgot to make that clear in the Quran. For example, okay, he says verses blabbering on and on about which women Muhammad can marry. Your sisters, your wives, your paternal uncle, your paternal, maternal, all the believing women. Okay, but he forgot to say which verses are to be taken for that time or generally. It's just about killing people, so it's not so important. By the way, you just admitted that the Taliban misunderstood the Islam. ISIS misunderstood Islam. Everybody misunderstands Islam. So is that any fault of your God that he keeps making verses without making it clear to what he is referring to in his clear book that he demands to make it the law, the constitution, you might kill them, you might not kill them, you never know. Farouk, given the fact that Islam also preaches offensive jihad, let me understand what you expect to happen. You will conquer places and then you will demand people to obey Muslim interpretations of urban myths of Arabia. And given the fact that your God, if he's not talking about which women Muhammad can have sex with, he's totally vague in his commands. And people keep misunderstanding him. So what should we do? Just trust Muslim scholars to command all aspects of our lives blindly? So we should trust Muslim scholars to command all aspects of our lives blindly. Hey, I read in Hadith, but it might be Sahid, but the other scholar says it's not so Sahid. It might be weak. Islam. One day we might understand why we are following a Nazi dictatorship. One day we might find out.
They're not generally taken about all non-Muslims in all different areas. So you need to learn that so that you don't misunderstand the Quran. Now, let's get back to your question. Your education will have to wait, all right? So.
Look, you Ibn Farouk, you little clownish idiot. You are not educating anyone. So far, you haven't said a word true in two videos. You imbecile. Okay, You are not educating anyone. You are just a comedy. Let's make that absolutely clear. And now you pissed me off. Okay, I've heard that once. I heard that twice. You being condescending. Okay. Let's continue. Or maybe I should do few videos more.
So, now, when you talk about the hukum of murtad, the murtad, right? First thing, which you're missing, is this is not generally for somebody who leaves Islam. This is for somebody who's under the khilafah, right? Like in Pakistan, for example, today. Okay, so you know that. Oh, why are you confused then?
I wouldn't. Right? I wouldn't say under the khilafah, but I see that it wouldn't apply over here.
No. So let's take it at Pakistan, for example, or Malaysia, right? Those are Muslim countries. People that become Christian are not put to death. You know that, right?
Blasphemy and apostasy. Blasphemy is punishable by death in Iran, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Brunei, Mauritania, and Saudi Arabia. Besides non-Muslims and Ahmadiyyas minorities, Pakistani minority Shias, too are accused of blasphemy. Since 2001, more than 2,600 Shia Muslims have been killed in violent attacks in Pakistan. Pakistan. Christian mother and her son brutally lynched to death by an Islamist mob over blasphemy. So, Pakistanis following the culture of Islam, they lynched to death for blasphemy. The Pakistani government has blasphemy laws. It doesn't implement them very often. The truth is that Islam seeks political domination, often using unethical ways to achieve that. Jihad, terrorism, violence, etc. It's an imperialistic cult with no ethics. Just because Ibn Farouk uses dawah, that doesn't mean that Islam is only dawah. Once Islam subjugates societies, we'll use intimidation, brainwashing, propaganda, draconian laws to keep people subjugated or mental slaves. Obviously, if Islam doesn't get rid of Sharia, it's an enemy to all decent societies and peoples, and should be resist with all costs, political or militarily. A political system with evil rules like death for apostasy can never be implemented. Okay, so God should have known that. So obviously Islam is not from God. There is no possible way an intelligent being will demand a evil dictatorship. If that is not evil, then there isn't any evils in this world. Denying freedom of conscience is the definition of evil. The definition. If you open the dictionary and you say, what is the definition of evil? It will say, denying freedom of conscience. Number one, my friend. Better kill a person than do that. Denying freedom of conscience is policing your mind. That is pure evil. If you ask the Satan, we want pure evil, bring us some evil, this is what he will bring. Pure evil. Denying the freedom of conscience. That is, if that is not evil, there isn't an evil. So, obviously, God cannot possibly demand from societies an evil dictatorship. So, obviously, Islam is not from God.
We're talking about Islam here.
We are talking about Islam. So, we're talking about... So when you talk about Islam, you said Muslim countries. When I talk about Muslim countries, you're talking about Islam.
It's very simple. If anyone leaves his religion, kill him.
But that
and
is,
I'm saying,
that is
do you
under,
kill someone for...
That is under al-bay'ah. When you have pledged, and there is a court system and a khilafah, because that comes under treason.
So, if you have a caliphate,
yes,
you have a caliphate,
yes,
and someone is in the Muslim community
who gives allegiance,
okay,
right?
So a Muslim, let's say. So you're a Muslim, and sure. then later on you change your mind,
sure.
and you decide to become a pagan.
Sure. So here,
does it apply there?
Sure. So let me
death penalty.
Let me clarify for you, bro. So when you are under a khilafah mm-hmm. and you give bay'ah, you have pledged an allegiance to the khilafah, right? Mm-hmm. At that time, then you become a murtad, meaning you leave Islam, but you don't tell anybody. This is between you. You just sit there and worship your own whatever at home. Nobody's going to kill you. Understand? But if you go out now under an Islamic khilafah, you give the allegiance and you start preaching towards other religions, right? A paganism, whatever. Deep religions who the khilafah may be at battle with. Then this is taken as treason. And you know in America also treason can have the death penalty, right?
Islam is totalitarian. That's the first. Secondly, Islam is aggressive and seeks world domination not only with dawah, but also with offensive jihad and creeping sharia. Three, Islam is incredibly evil, untrue, and stupid, and destroys societies. So that's three. Now you put the icing on the cake, the cherry on the cake, and you say, once Islam dominates, we will suppress all deviance with draconian laws. Okay. Congratulations. So, you completed the evil. You made a whole cycle of evil. Look, Farouk, you should wish for political Islam to die out quietly before you have any power, so you can save some suffering. Because there is one fact: political Islam will be defeated. That's a fact. Political Islam will be defeated. Now, you have two options. Either quietly, like right now, like you are doing now, okay, you make philosophy, and years pass along and Islam dies from it. People understand that this is stupid. This is the good scenario. The other scenario is you having political power and you will be defeated militarily. There isn't any third scenario, my friend. So, you need to make some soul searching. Because this is your two options. There isn't third option. Okay, thank you very much, people.